Greetings to all of you. Here we are, March the 26th, 2023, here at Congregational Church of the Valley, as we gather together up close or at a distance. We hope that everyone will be blessed in perhaps some unexpected way. We're glad that you are with us, no matter how you find your way to us. Before we receive the message today, would you join me around the piano where we gather to be blessed by the marvelous music of Larry Loeber.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, the ninth chapter, starting with verse 51. When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. But they did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem.
Today I want to talk about Jesus and conflict. From the Gospel of Luke, one short verse there we have. Before we dive into that, please erase all you know about Jesus and begin again. Oh, as I say that, we are so desperate, inside, outside the church, to erase all of those images, most of which are inaccurate, and begin again. And let the essence of Jesus' message come to the top. when everything is boiled down in the entire Bible, my Old Testament professor said, don't you ever forget, there's only one word that comes to the top, and that is love. Jesus fulfilled four different roles. Jesus challenged conventional wisdom. Boy, that's an understatement. Secondly, Jesus came to call his people home to restore Judaism, not to start a new religion. He had no intention of that. Item three, Jesus was a prophet, which I will call as a subheading, a divine irritant. Oftentimes the prophets were people that the kings didn't want to be around. They said, oh man, there he is nagging again, telling us about this and that, about justice and stuff. But oftentimes they didn't want to kill those prophets. They knew that what they were saying that they needed to hear, but they just didn't want to hear it. So a prophet is a divine irritant. Jesus, I need to tell you, did not foretell the future. He told it the way it is. Sometimes we get confused about that. Oh, a prophet is the one who tells the future. Not at all. They're ones who tell it the way it is, and most of the time it makes us uncomfortable. Jesus, number four, did not run from conflict, nor did he try to start it. Our text is that transitional moment in the life of Jesus. Jesus set his face toward Jerusalem. You see, Jesus did not go to Jerusalem to die, but to be followed. His death was the outcome of his journey, not the intention of his journey. Jesus faced Jerusalem with these truths that the world was not ready to receive. Here are these truths that the world just was not ready to receive. The first one is, don't judge because you don't know how to do it. Judge not. Why? Because we will always judge most harshly in others what is weakest in us. Can we contemplate on that a little bit? We will always judge most harshly in others what is weakest in us. The best deal from Jesus is a measuring stick. The measuring stick that you use to judge other people will be the same one used on you. And incidentally, I don't mean that you're standing in heaven and Jesus saying, you know, you are really a judgmental to these people. So, you know, and so I'm going to use that measure on you. I'm not talking about that. Psychologically, in this world, it is true that those who suffer greatly are those that are projecting their own faults on other people, on the off chance that they might feel better after doing that, and they never do. There was a person by the name of Sidney Simon who had this little book that became very popular, particularly in my youth groups, Negative Criticism and What You Can Do About It. So in there, the writer said, are you sure that none of your own hang-ups, your own deep-seated psychological needs, hurts, or fears are causing you to make this criticism? That question alone would bring silence to 99% of the negative criticism that permeates our streets, our offices, our classrooms, and our homes. Second point, the power of God is persuasive, persuasive presence, not shortcuts on life. God never promises to take us away from any of life's experiences, but promises to go with us through all of them. That is the beauty of the God that was revealed in Jesus. You remember the fact that we say at Christmas time that Jesus coming to us, he's Christ, he is Emmanuel. That means God is with us. Or if you start thinking about some of the Gospels and some of the passages that are on in there, we would like God to come to us in a different way. Please make it easier, but he comes as companion. God is with us. And in the end, we will find that that is enough, but it doesn't feel like it at the time. My dear friend Robert Capon talked about a snowstorm, and he was talking about the actions of God. He says there's a man who's out, he gets stuck in a snowstorm, and he's all out of gas after he's had the car running for a while. And he said that here's this man in there freezing in that car. He says, God doesn't put in a new battery. God doesn't put gas in the car. God simply comes, opens the door, and says, scoot over. You and I are going to go through this together. I find that kind of God worthy of praise. There is a South Pacific tribe that have a habit of moving into a hospital until life is restored to the one they love. You know, God is like that. He moves in until everything is restored. Behold, I make all things new. My friend Bill Coffin preached a very, very expensive sermon in about 1981-82 entitled Alex's Death. His son was killed in an accident in the middle of the night outside of Boston. And so he was asked later on, what kind of things helped you in the middle of the loss of your son, who was, I think, 21 or 22 years of age? He says, there are many, many, many cards that came. Thinking of you, signed your brokenhearted sister. Clergy, he said, use scripture. Scripture is self-protection to pretty up a situation whose bleakness they simply cannot face. End of quote. He says, God is with us when in silence we suffer with another. Another thing here, God wills and wants our well-being and will finally have his way. At one time, I preached a sermon series called The Will of God and enjoyed it greatly. My board chairman came to me at one time and he says, you know, it grieves me as to how much damage is done with the misused phrase, the will of God. I said, you're right. After all the business of the church, this is our first business, clarity about who God is and who God is not. What kind of damage is done with the misuse of the phrase, the will of God? I was conducting a workshop with about 50 men in a circle in Minnesota. And we were spending there 2 days as a community building project. And on the second day, there was a man who said, almost nonchalantly, he said, you know, I need to tell you about my daughter who died at 7 years of age. She had this terrible disease. We had to give her shots and all this kind of stuff. Later on, my wife and I were divorced. He said it was just a hideous experience. And then he said, almost casually, he says, you know, I've never cried at her death. I've never shed a tear. And then someone asked, of course, well, why not? He said, well, there's some religious people who live next door. And they came to me and told me that I need to accept the death of my daughter because it was the will of God for something I did that was very bad in my life. The silence was deafening for 1 minute. And the man sitting next to him said, "Do you know what they told you was just a lot of crap?" He said, "I always thought so, but I'm not religious and didn't think that I had the right to question it." And that man broke into 30 minutes of tears gushing down his face that were held back by somebody saying the will of God when the opposite of God's will was being done. Bill Coffin, with the death of his son, Alex, he said he went up to his sister's place there outside of Boston, and he came in there, and there was a woman who came into the room, and she looked at him and said, "I just don't understand the way of the will of God." And Coffin was kind of put off by it. And so he came to her and said, "Okay, ma'am." He was kind of tired of hearing that kind of thing, both in church and his own life. And now with the death of his son, it was the implication that God had, you know, killed Alex. And he said, "Do you think it was the will of God that his windshield wiper didn't work? Do you think it was the will of God that he was probably driving too fast, that he had probably been drinking too much?" And he said in his sermon, the one thing that should never be said when someone dies is, "It is the will of God." Never do we know enough to say that. For some reason, nothing so infuriates me as the incapacity of seemingly intelligent people to get it through their heads that God doesn't go around this world with his fingers on triggers, his fist around knives, his hands on steering wheels. God is dead set against all unnatural deaths. Christ spent an inordinate amount of time delivering people from paralysis, insanity, leprosy, and muteness. There are natural caused deaths that are untimely and slow and pain-ridden and raise unanswerable questions. But violent deaths, such as one Alex died, to understand those is a piece of cake. As his brother said, simply standing at the head of the casket at the Boston funeral home, "You blew it, my buddy. You really blew it." Coffin says that my only consolation lies in knowing that it was not the will of God that Alex die, that when the waves closed over the sinking car, God's heart was the first of all of our hearts to break. God's heart is first of all, the first heart of all of our hearts to be broken. And we need to get straight about that essence of God rather than the one who's pulling strings all the time in the world and causing harms. That is the only way God helps us. God suffers with us. And so here we are. Jesus set his face toward Jerusalem, not to die, but to be followed. And instead of being followed, he was murdered by indifference. He helped us by telling the truth. My God, why have you forsaken me?" You ever feel like that? Well, Jesus blazed that trail for you. Ever felt like that? By telling the truth of our own experience, we make room to hear these words. "Why have you come seeking the living among the dead? He is not here." Thanks be to God, who promises to take us away from nothing, but promises to go with us through everything until that day that God makes all things new. May we contemplate and be blessed by these words. Amen.
Will you pray with me? Almighty God, who designed this world to be full of joy and gladness, may the music of this day form a melody of earnest praise to you, whom we have seen more clearly in the face of Jesus of Nazareth. Naturally, our hearts open to your love. We crave your forgiving understanding. In deep, profound thankfulness, we turn to you, always knowing that we can count on your grace. May our Palm Sunday praise be no hollow mockery that give way to Good Friday scorn, but may our outer joy be sincere expression of inner desire and devotion. Eternal God, it was said of Jesus, a child shall lead them. Give us a questioning child-like stance as we stand before your word each week. Help us to listen with our hearts and more than our heads. We think today of Jesus, who set his face to go to Jerusalem. Give us the courage of conviction that we may not shrink from the harder paths of a dutiful life that lie ahead. With this prayer go prayers for the leaders of our nation, for our world in turmoil and need, for our own members who are sick or sad or grieving. We think today of those whose needs we bring to this moment in worship. O God of love and life, visit us with your power and grant us your peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, Our Father who is in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
Eternal God, bless us as we leave this place, hopefully with a new clarity of where you are in our life, not as the one who makes things happen, but the one who sits by us as everything happens to us in life. We praise you for your presence. Bless us in ways that we need this day more than any way we know to ask, and we will give you the praise. Amen.